And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do climate science. This is the science. This is not Rush Limbaugh. This is not Al Gore. This is the real stuff. And I'll start with this slide. The blue is the climate over the last 400,000 years. That pattern has been there for the last 4 million years. When climatologists first saw this, they said, oh my God, we're going to go into an ice age. You got to read this from right to left. Climatologists and geologists and everybody puts their charts backwards. Now is to the left, old is to the right. It also has CO2 in green, and CO2 in the past has been a trailing variable. In other words, the climate heats up, then you get the CO2. And as I said, when climatologists first looked at that, they said, oh no, we're overdue for an ice age, we're in big trouble. Ice ages are major things. When you have an ice age, you have famines, people die, it's awful. If we're to have an ice age now, we'd be in big trouble. There are 8 major factors that affect the climate. And when we go down one at a time, the output of the sun, particles in the air, gases in the air, the orbit tilt, the eccentricity, the rotation of the tilt to the apogee and perigee, buildings of cities, and a location in the plane of the galaxy. We only have a little bit of control. People think we're big shots, we control everything. The truth is, we don't. This is kind of in one equation. The sun shines on us, a lot of it's reflected, actually a little less than a third is reflected. That heats the planet. When things are warm, they radiate. Outer space is 457 degrees below zero. It's real cold. If you get out on a clear night and you don't have much on, you just have a bathing suit and a clear night, you'll say, boy, it's cold, because it's 457 degrees below zero out there. And that's the one-third's reflected, the two-thirds heat the planet. This shows the output of the sun. It shows sunspots, but they really very well correlated. We had a Maunder minimum back in the late 1600s. People died. Crops failed. All of the grapes that they were growing in England died. Vikings had outposts up in Greenland. The people there abandoned them and came back, or they died. We've had a relatively high sun output recently. Only very recently it's gone down a little bit, which is a little scary. This is the sun output in the last, well, since 1975. Goes up and down, approximately 11-year cycle. However, this last cycle got extended. It's ended up lower, so we have less sun output right now. There are orbital effects, and two I point out is eccentricity. Comets go in and out of the orbit. They are, on average, have the same orbital energy as the Earth. They're dirty snowballs because they spend a lot of time away. They zip by the sun and go back out. The Earth is pretty much circular, so we have the climate we have. If we are more eccentric, we will be more like comets, dirty snowballs. The other one is in and out of the plane of the galaxy. Galaxy, all the stars going around, they don't go around in neat orbits. They kind of go goofy as they go around. And when we are out of the plane, we are colder. We are headed out of the plane, so we're headed towards cold. Now, the rate is about 62 million years, more or less. And as they bump around, it changes. But we have a while before we get cold. But we are on the way to cold in a We have greenhouse gases and anti-greenhouse gases. Carbon dioxide, methane, we've all heard about those. Sulfur dioxide. When you put sulfur dioxide in the upper atmosphere, cools the planet. Volcanoes do that. We haven't had a big one go off in a while. Soot. Diesel engines make soot. Soot lands on ice in the poles. That's warming. But the smog, if you will, and the fine dust in the air is cooling. And if you've been in China or Vietnam or Thailand or any place in South Asia or in Asia, period, you know that it just smog. And that is cooling the planet. If they suddenly cleaned up their act, we would have a warmer planet. Clouds do both. When we had the 9/11, the airplanes weren't flying. We got a lot of data. A lot of data came out of that. People learned what clouds do because we didn't have the upper stratus clouds that airplanes cause. And climatologists learned a lot. This one we got to see. This is carbon dioxide. When the climatologists saw that earlier chart, they saw that pattern, they panicked. We're going into an ice age. Here we had Professor Mann at Penn State and a lot of other people saw this chart and said, oh no, we're going to cook. We're headed towards runaway heating and the oceans are going to fill up, the poles are going to melt. And so they published articles. Now in science, if you can't make a prediction, then people say that's baloney. Scientists need to make predictions if they're going to have good, provable theories. They made predictions, the predictions didn't come true. So they fudged the data. They lied. And they tried to keep people who were telling the truth from telling the truth. And as a result, all of that climatology stuff is now bunk. Both sides. All of what they did is bunk. All the guys that are against them were bunk. It's all bunk. And I have another chart that just shows some recent climate data. And this is all of the guys, all of the big guys in the business, combined all of their charts. You can see how this chart is really not too much related to that chart. So the carbon dioxide is an effect, but it's not all of what's doing it. Some people at NASA, the global, satellite outfit at NASA, put together and they said, we can make an equation, we can predict this all. They put together a prediction and they got it 76% accuracy, they could predict the past. Not good. If you're a statistician, you would say that's not very good, particularly when it was a relatively short period. So they can't predict even the past. Where are we now? We have low sun output, which is cooling the climate. We have higher carbon dioxide, which is warming the climate. Low levels of sulfur dioxide, comparatively speaking, because of the lack of big volcanoes going off, which makes the climate warmer. We have fine particles, which is cooling the climate. Large particles are heating the climate. The orbit, right now we're pretty circular, so we're pretty warm. As the orbit gets in and out of this circular pattern, we're going to have some cooling. And we keep building roads and buildings and things, and they are warming, particularly when you put black tar asphalt on the top. Science conclusion. The climate has always been changing. Always will be changing. Humans are having an effect, no doubt, but it's overwhelmed by all the other stuff. If you go back to the initial chart, the things we have control of are pretty limited. There's only a few things we have control over, and they aren't the major drivers. We can predict the past with 76% accuracy. The future is less predictable. I think it was Yogi Berra said, making predictions is really hard, particularly about the future. So I think that's the case. Some changes can be fast. The most recent ice age, there's some data that it started snowing in England and didn't quit until the ice was quite a few miles thick. So it can happen quick. It can happen, I guess the sun decides to cool off a little bit and we're in for it. So we need to be concerned about that. What's going to happen in terms of future climate disruptions? Supervolcanoes are going to go off. We had a couple in the last couple hundred years down in Indonesia, Tambora and Krakatoa, both of which caused what was then called the year without a summer. Crops failed all over the world. That is going to happen again. There's no way to turn off the supervolcanoes from going off. We have one of them, it's called Yellowstone. So that one would not only devastate crops throughout the world, it would really devastate our country. Comets. We think we can handle the asteroids, and maybe we can. Comets, we can't. Comets are surprise. There's a comet. They enter our area more than twice as fast as an asteroid. No warning, here's comet, slam, we get it. And they'll hit us at about 50,000 miles an hour, plus or minus, versus asteroids at about 25,000 miles an hour. Lunatics with nuclear bombs, we got to worry about that. If all of the bombs that are now in Israel, Pakistan, and all those guys around there, they decide to start throwing nuclear bombs, we will have a nuclear winter. It will be like a super volcano. We don't want them to start doing that. And if anybody knows how to stop that, there's probably people that would really be interested in hearing about it. The sun output causing an ice age, I think that's certain. The sun has been changing, always will be changing. That's its business, and we are going to have cooling. Out of the plane of galaxy, as we get out of the plane of galaxy, work has been done in CERN that we will have global cooling, and we're headed that way. That's a slow process. Runaway greenhouse gases is uncertain. Nobody has good data to say that's going to happen. And as a matter of fact, just as people would say the poles, the Arctic is warming up, well, the Antarctic is cooling down. And that has to do with the tilt of the axis of the Earth with respect to the orbit. So this is a process that's happening all the time. All of the above are going to cause famine. And you say, okay, what can we do about it? If the sun turns down, we can't. If we have a super volcano, we can't. There's a lot of those things that are going to happen, certain things that we can't do anything about. On the too warm side, we can flood the water in depression. I can tell you folks about that. We can increase the level of the Dead Sea. We can seed the sea with iron. We can bury yard waste in organic waste. Realize composting puts the carbon dioxide back in. We could just bury it and take the carbon dioxide out. We could burn hydrogen sulfide in high altitude aircraft. We could pretend we're a super volcano and actually affect the climate. So things we can do. The big thing we can do is wealth. Wealth in that we need to prepare foodstuffs, stocks, we need to do all of the things to get ready for whatever direction it's going to go, because it's certain to go in some direction. Again, Yogi Berra, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. Well, we are in a fork of the road and we're going to take it. And anybody who tells you they know which direction it's going is very suspect. And with that, questions? Yes, yes, sir, in the back.
Our Environmental Protection Agency, if I'm not mistaken, in its eminent wisdom, has declared that carbon monoxide is now a hazardous gas.
Carbon dioxide.
If I'm not mistaken, what is that? Has that changed now, the approach that you're taking?
We don't know. And let me just go back to the original original slide. Why didn't we fall into an ice age? Some theory is it's because we've had the Industrial Revolution and put a lot of carbon dioxide into the air that we might have stopped an ice age. I don't know. I don't think the people that came up with that can come up with enough data, but I wouldn't try to do anything about anything other than get ready for whatever is going to happen. In other words, I think we ought to spend whatever effort we spend on getting ready for an ice age or getting ready for the warming. And I think getting ready for warming is pretty easy. For example, I said seed the seas with iron. That's already been done. An outfit put iron in the ocean in order to increase the growth of algae and therefore increase fish. And they did it in an island in the South Pacific, and it worked. And it did take carbon dioxide out of the air, and it did increase the fish level, and it was a success, but it wasn't economic. But if you wanted to really stop global warming, and you'd say, well, okay, we can do that in a big scale. I mean, these guys did it in a really little scale. Do it in a big scale. One atom of iron takes out 400,000 molecules of carbon dioxide. So it's really efficient. One of the climatologists said, give me a super tanker full of iron and I'll give you an ice age.
My concern is by declaring it a hazardous gas, does that not also give our government the ability to control anything that emanates carbon dioxide, including human beings?
Our government right now has been given the control over everything. That's a problem separate from this. We need to get the government out of control. Yes. Yes, sir.
You know, I was looking here at the Bible where it says that over the last 100 years or century that the temperatures increased by about 14%. Some years ago, George Winwick was our speaker here at the Rotary Club, and he indicated back then that they'd only been keeping accurate weather records since about 1900. So my question is, how do they know that the temperatures increased by 14% if they only been keeping accurate weather records for 112 years?
Well, that. I disavow all of that. That's all bunk. That's all part of the bunk. I don't know who wrote that or where they got the data. It's all part of the bunk. And you just have to say, hold your ears and say, no, I know it's all bunk. I know they don't know which way it's going. They can't predict the weather tomorrow. They're not going to predict the climate in 10 years. And by the way, we have some data back earlier. I showed the Maunder minimum. You know, we had this medieval maximum. We had a maximum some time back. And that's what caused them to plant all the grapes and grapevines in England and all that. So we did have a warm climate. And we've pretty much gotten back there. But that's about where we are. Okay, all anything right. else? Or I'm
all
done.
Right. Okay, yep. All good. Right, Bob, thank you very much.
Yes, sir.